Well, y'all are just showing off for the company now. That's. I just have a couple of announcements to make. First is the quilters and sewers have started meeting up on Tuesday, 6:30 to 9. They call it open sew. They just get together, work on their stuff, share ideas. If you're at all interested, if you've ever thought about it but haven't come out yet, this would be the perfect time to come out, meet the other ladies and see if it fits you or if you want to just learn how to sew. I know they can teach you how to do that because I have seen them work miracles with some of the people in the church. I was going to mention some names, but I don't want to get in trouble. So, obviously things are a little different here today. You see the front is looking much more handsome than it usually is. This is nice. This is nice. We are absolutely thrilled to invite. Do we have a name for the group? Are we?
The No Name Band.
All right, huh? But the No Name Band do have names, so I just want to introduce and thanks personally Bob Hauser, who plays the bass and does vocal, Kemedy Hauser, his daughter, that he roped in at a very early age. She says she's not been held hostage. She enjoys it, so it's okay. All right, Phil Lone Ranger. Loringer, he told me how to say it, and Tom Wysocki, who I've been working with to put this all together. So again, just a little love and appreciation as we get ready to start the service.
Before we go, I have to make one comment. Now, just to make it clear, Kemedy was the one that got Bob into bluegrass. Bob, the professional classical cellist, and from what I heard, when Kemedy got interested in bluegrass, hated the idea. Said no. But of course, Kemedy got what she wanted. So Kemedy actually brought Bob in. Once Bob got into it, well, you can see, here he is. And he still does play his classical cello and that. So
I just wanted to make that clear. I told them all we're real relaxed. Now, is she your only daughter? Oh, yeah, the youngest, they got you. Yeah, okay. I know, I have experience that way. That's all I have by way of announcements. Is there anything else that needs to be brought up? Joey.
Good morning. I just want to remind everyone that we are still having coffee and downstairs afterwards. And don't forget about the silent auction. There's some cool stuff down there. We've got some Blantons down there. We got some Cooper's Hawk, 3-month wine club members. We got a basket for stuff that ladies put on themselves and take off themselves. What else? Oh, there's grilling stuff down there. So please take a look down there and see if I'm sure you'll find something that appeals to you. Spa basket, very good. And there's lots of food down there too. And by the way, the silent auction will end July 30th, so the person that's the farthest down the list and has money on the 30th, they will win that basket, so.
And Joey, you're gonna hear about this for quite a long time. What the ladies put on and take off. That's going to find its way into a sermon, I guarantee you that, brother. That's going to show up. That's going to show. We may get even more visitors if we do that, right? Okay.
I just have a quick announcement. All the wonderful people who moved everything up last Sunday, the piano bench and the accoutrements on the altar, they need to go back downstairs again this Sunday after church. So if you would help out, we'd really appreciate it. Thank you.
And just real quick, we had the parking for the Bluegrass Festival there. Made a little over $1,000 yesterday. So we're real pleased. We were really worried because at the end of the 12:30 when the first shift was over, the parking lot was just about half full because of the rain and stuff, but it picked up and you can't keep a good bluegrass fan down, right? They're gonna come out in any kind of weather. Anything else? Right? Come, all who are weary and heavy laden. Here in Christ, you will find rest. Please join with me responsibly in our call to worship. This is the day that the Lord has made.
Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
Now I invite all that are able to please stand as we join into the hymn, Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing. Please join with me in the morning prayer. You have walked many miles with us, O God. You have comforted and strengthened us along the way. Keep us on your path, for we easily lose our way. As we learn to live in your ways, help us choose the cause of justice and righteousness. Amen. Now, I'm going to turn you loose to greet each other, but before I do that, while you're passing the peace with each other, the ladies are going to be passing the bucket around. We're going to be collecting for our musicians that have come and so freely given of their time. So please, I know we call it bang the bucket, but I really don't want to hear a lot of banging because dollar bills don't make any noise. So greet each other and get ready to fill the basket.
Treasure.
Now, I was assured by Tom they would not be offended if you all clapped while they were singing along, too. That's part of the bluegrass thing, isn't it? Yeah. So they're not used to playing in a bunch of a stuffy German group like us, right? Okay. Oh, no, this has been great so far. Thank you so much. We come to the time in our service of worship where we have the opportunity to lift up and to share with sisters and brothers in Christ the concerns and the joys of our hearts and of our lives. So at this time, I invite any and all that feel so led to share your concerns or joys at this time.
I would ask for continued prayers for my friend's son, Devin Torno. He's 60. He had the quadruple bypass. He's not doing very well. He has paralysis in his throat. And so he can't hardly talk, he can hardly swallow. He's lost a lot of weight, and he's got, where they did some of the cutting, he can hardly move his one arm. So please keep him in your prayers.
Thank you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Well, Ralph Eisenbrandt was in the hospital. He's still there. He's supposed to be coming home. He was having some stomach issues. They needed to take care of him. They wanted to keep him because they wanted to try to fix it without doing surgery, because Ralph's kind of fragile and he's had a bunch of surgeries done. So they were able to take care of it. Now he's able to go home. The only problem is he can't go home by himself. So they gave Ralph the option. They said, well, we can hire somebody to come stay with you. And Ralph said, are you out of your mind? And that wasn't going to happen. So he is going to be spending some time with his daughter, Wendy, and her family. He's going to be moving in with them for a little while as he gets himself backs up to strength and then is able to get back to his home and his daily routine. So we'll want to keep Ralph, and we'll especially want to keep Wendy and her family in our thoughts and prayers as they go through this time of convalescence. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Quiet today. All right. We'll take these concerns and joys that we've shared together. We will take the concerns and joys of our heart that we choose to share quietly and privately with God as we bow our heads and enter into a time and a spirit of prayer. Holy and loving God, we give you thanks for this incredible day. The blue, bright sunshine. The blue sky and the bright sunshine. The opportunity to gather and to celebrate with such joyous music. We give you thanks for these folks that have come to join Lisa in sharing their gift of music with us and helping us to feel your spirit in a way that is quite different from the way we usually do it here at St. Peter's. I truly pray, God, that this spirit that they bring to us may enliven us, enrich us, nurture us, and empower us to look for new ways to give thanks and praise to God, realizing that there are so many songs, so many tunes, so many words, so many proclamations, and so many deeds that can be done by people. People that wish to just serve you and to praise you. Be with us as a congregation as we continue to grow in our faith, to grow in our sense of discipleship, and to always grow in our love and our trust in you. Holy One, we lift this prayer up to you this morning as we have shared with you our concerns and our joys, and we bring them all to you when we pray together as one. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And now these words from the prophet Micah. Pardon me? Oh, okay. So if the kids would like to go to children's church, anybody third grade and under is welcome to go. Now we'll hear from the prophet Micah. With what shall I come before the Lord? and bow myself before God on high? Shall I come before him with burnt offerings, with calves a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams and 10,000s of rivers of oil? Shall I give my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? God has told you, O mortal, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you? But to do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with your God. Hear what the Spirit says to the church. So I hope you noted in this short passage one of my favorite in all of Scripture. It's one of the few scriptures that kids that go through confirmation have to memorize. What does the Lord require of you? But to do justice, to love kindness, love mercy, and to walk humbly with God. You know, they're all verbs. They're all actions that we are required to do. It doesn't say here, God has suggested to you, O mortal, what is good. God has told you, O mortal, what is good. The word of God has proclaimed to us through the prophet Micah what is expected of us, what is demanded of us if we are to be able to think about calling ourselves followers of the living God and for us of the risen Christ. It doesn't say anything in here about what you believe. It doesn't say anything in here about what you proclaim through professions of faith or statements of faith or liturgies or prayers. God is very, very specific through Micah in telling us what we have to do. Do justice. Now, this is not the justice that we have created in the world. The justice that, if we look anywhere, is not applied freely or equally within our country or any country. Quite frankly, any that's ever existed. There are always people in every civilization and every society that are just treated differently on both ends of the spectrum. People with power treated differently because, well, they have power. And we don't want to make them mad because, well, they have power. And then people on the other end of the spectrum, people that have nothing tangible, that many in society would look down upon and see them as a drain, as those that just suck away from the abundance that should be ours, but that we have to give to them because we just feel like we have to. When we think about the justice that Micah is talking about here, it's the justice of God, where each and every individual is seen for what we are, a beloved child of God, each and every one of us. Now, I have scoured Scripture for decades and engaged theologians in discussions. And I have yet to find anywhere, nor can anybody point out to me any place where it even begins to give the notion that God loves one group of people more than another. Genesis, it says, and God created man and woman. In the image of God, man and woman were created. It does not say, in the image of God, American men and women were created. Or French. Or Chinese. Or Russian. Or Ukrainian. Fill in the blank. It doesn't say anywhere that white people, white men and women, were made in the image of God. It doesn't say that anywhere. So we can infer that that the men and women that are created in the image of God are all races, are all ethnicities, come from all the different nations, that come from different belief systems. For I truly, truly believe that God has made himself manifest through all of the great faiths of the world. And none having priority over the other. As long as you do justice, as long as you see each and every individual as a beloved child of God, therefore a sister or a brother, and then treat them with respect, with honor, with dignity, or as Jesus said very succinctly, to treat them as you would want to be treated yourself. It says to do kindness. Some places it says to love mercy. Just be nice to people. Now, I know standing up here, that sounds like a real simple thing, but if you look out in the world right now, there is a serious lack of kindness and niceness and mercy in the world. There just is. Now, there are examples of it, and those examples are the things that we should be grasping onto, saying, see, it can happen, it can be done. But unfortunately, all of us, if we're honest with ourselves, all of us all too often find it easy to go back to not being so kind or not being so merciful. We have created a society and a culture of judgment where everything is either right or wrong. I blame it on the computers that we've created, because the computers work on a binary system. Everything is a one or a zero. That's it, one or zero. Now, everything's made up of those ones or zeros, but at the very core, it's either one or it's zero. And we've taken that into our hearts and our minds to, okay, there's either right or there's wrong. Now, in some cases, that is true. But in many, there's always that gray that we need to be willing to open ourselves up to. So that even when it is wrong, we can call it wrong, but we can try to find out why that wrong was done. What was behind it? And many, many times, again, if we are honest, and I understand how tough that is for me, if I'm going to be honest with myself, I'm going to see that a lot of the things that are viewed as wrong, I've had a good part in making them come to pass through my choices, through the things I support. I have helped to not just create, but to perpetuate a society that just isn't very merciful. It's very judgmental. And again, we find in the scriptures where God very clearly claims there is only one judge, and that is God. Jesus says, don't judge, because if you do, you're going to be judged. Jesus teaches us to be merciful. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall see the kingdom of God. Blessed are those that are kind, for they shall be the children of God. Jesus didn't make this stuff up out of broadcloth. Remember, Jesus was first and foremost a Jew. And he would have been intimately familiar with the scriptures of the Hebrew people, and especially of the prophets. So all Jesus was doing was taking these things, in this case from Micah, and saying, yes, that's the way it has to be. Do justice, love, mercy, and kindness. For if you do, then you shall be blessed. And then the last is to walk humbly with God. As I've talked about before, I've got like five questions when I, if I ever get a chance to go to heaven, and if I ever get a chance to talk to God, I got five questions I'm going to ask him. Say, I'm not leaving until you answer these five questions. One of them is, what's this humbly stuff? What do you mean by humbly? We don't live in a humble society, especially now. We've created a society where it's seen as normal to take credit for everything. We've created a society based upon the notion of pulling yourself up by the bootstrap, putting your nose to the grindstone, the self-made man or woman. Mike is telling us very clearly that's not the way it's supposed to be. Everything and anything comes through the blessings of God. God does not like us better. The people that are seated here right now does not like us better than the people that are living in Ethiopia who are watching their children starve because there's no food, because there hasn't been any rain in 3 years. We are blessed to be here, not preferred, not better, but we are blessed. And when Micah tells us, when God tells us through Micah to walk humbly with God, that is to accept these blessings humbly. None of us did anything to be born in the station where we find ourselves today. It is a blessing, one that we are called to humbly accept, and then to find ways to repay in whatever small ways we can. Repay for these blessings by offering them up as much as we possibly can to anyone that's in need. Remember, Jesus told the rich young ruler who was blessed. Rich young ruler said, hey, I keep the commandments. I don't cheat on my wife. I don't beat my kids. I don't swear. I do all the good stuff in life. What more do you want from me? You remember what Jesus said? Give away everything you got to the poor. He was telling him to humble yourself and to realize that in the eyes of God, we are all the same. And through the choices that we make, we all find ourselves woefully, woefully short of even beginning to deserve the grace of God. This is, in these short verses, this is the blueprint for the kingdom of God. And it's the blueprint for each and every one of our lives. If we are willing to accept what God commands of us, if we can find a way to justly treat everybody, to be kind to everyone, to be kind and just with all of God's creation, and to humbly understand and accept that all that we have and all that we are truly is a blessing from God. And then find ways to share it joyfully. Giving to people in need while we give praise to God. God doesn't want all the fancy services. God doesn't want the sacrifice of lambs and oil. Other prophets will tell us that God looks down upon the worship and scorns because it's so empty, because it doesn't have the justice and the mercy and the humility. My hope and prayer for us as individuals, for us as a gathered body that's here, for us as a nation, for us as a world, is that we can understand that there truly is only one way that this world can be as God intended when God breathed life into people and brought the light from the dark, to live as God commands, to do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with God. Amen. So now we're going to do a little different today, too. We're going to be sharing in the hymn with you guys, right? So we're going to follow along, and y'all have the words there. I purposely didn't put the musical notes so that we didn't sing the wrong thing. We're going to be following their tune. And I keep telling them, we're real relaxed here, and at the end of the day, God's going to be praised. So if it doesn't go exactly the way we hoped, that's okay. So I invite all that are able to please stand. Just a closer walk with thee.
And before we start, I'll give you all one warning. After the second time we do the refrain, we're going to give Kennedy a chance to do a little, what we call in bluegrass, a little break for us. And then we'll finish up with the last verse. Okay? Thank you.
May we respond to God's faithful commitment to always be our God. With faithful love to those who are in need, let us give our gifts this day. Please join with me in the prayer of dedication. Generous God, may these gifts celebrate your name among the nations. May the lives we live celebrate your name for all time and all generations. Receive these offerings as signs of our praise, both now and forevermore. Amen. Now let us join together in Be Thou My Vision. Please join with me in the commission for this upcoming week responsibly. People of St. Peter's, God has told you what is good. And what does the Lord require of you? Let us join together now and let there be peace on earth. Don't forget that there's coffee and downstairs. Everybody, please go down and join, continue to join in fellowship and praise as we continue this beautiful day. I'd like to show our appreciation just once again for these guys. They were great. As I was listening to them, I kept thinking one thought in my mind. House band. Just a thought. So now may the God who feels compassion for all lead you to find love in your life and peace, and the peace that comes from living with a gentle and a humble heart. Amen. Please be seated as we listen to their last offering of music.
No sickness, no toil, no danger.
Rusty.